Let's praise him this morning.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name.
Come on, let's sing with us.
Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name.
This is why you see
every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, when there's pain in the offering. Blessed be your name.
Every blessing, come on.
Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. And when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glory.
Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Grace Fellowship Baptist Church, and we are so privileged that we can serve you this morning.
Amen.
And how lucky are we that we can all come together as a family and worship. I just want to let you guys know Vacation Bible School is coming up, and we are very excited about it. There are still a few spots available, so if you'd like to ask me any questions or help, we would love to have you. We could still use some help in recreation. If you like playing games, this is the perfect spot for you. Also, Brother Oscar could use some assistance in registration. So if you are good at just greeting people and helping them sign up for Vacation Bible School, I promise I have bribed Brother Oscar to be nice. So, it will be a lot of fun. Also, if you want to do something non-threatening, then you can be on the cleanup crew and help us get everything cleaned up at the end of each night. So we just have a lot of different areas. And also, something special that we like to do for our volunteers, many of whom are coming straight from work and coming straight here to work all evening in Vacation Bible School. So we like to feed them a meal. And we have a special little volunteer area where they can come, they can kind of sit down, they can kind of let the day go and just switch over to letting God take control and working for the kingdom and have a nice meal. So if you would like to volunteer for a meal for our to bring for dinner for our volunteers, we would love to have that as well. And you don't have to actually bring the meal if you don't want to. Some people choose to just donate money, and then we just order food. So you can always do that as well. Also, Brother Bill would like to invite everybody to attend a special hymn sing at Dallas Baptist University. It's on April 26th. Mm-hmm. So we're letting everybody know in plenty of time so you can get this on your calendars. It's at 1:30 p.m. If you are interested in attending, please let Bill or Alice know. And again, it is at Dallas Baptist University, but please don't let that deter you. We will have a little caravan going. We'll have people driving, so you can always hitch a ride with somebody. Definitely make sure that you attend if you want to go, because it's going to be beautiful. Also, we want to invite everybody to join us for Palm Sunday. We're going to have a very beautiful Palm Sunday service on March 24th. And then we are also doing something new. We are doing a very special Good Friday service. It's going to be at 6 p.m. on March 29th, which is a Friday, surprisingly. Then we're going to have a beautiful special sacred Easter service for you guys on Sunday, March 31st. So make sure you invite all your friends and family and join us for this very special time. And also, we would like to invite everybody, if you like to make a joyful noise to the Lord, that is all we ask. We would love to have you join our praise team. Brother Bill and the praise team bring us beautiful music and worship on Sundays. They do special services for Easter and Christmas, things like that. So we would love to have you join them. And they are a fun bunch of people, let me tell you. So if you are interested, again, just let Brother Bill or Alice know. If you have questions, they'll be happy to answer those. And we would also love to have you join our church family. So if that's something that you're interested in, again, feel free to grab Brother Oscar or Brother Bill and just let them know that you are interested in joining our church. We'll be happy to answer any questions you have, or we'll be also be happy to welcome you to our family. Now we're going to turn this back over to Brother Bill and the praise team, speaking of a fun bunch of people, and they have a special service planned for you.
Please stand for the reading of God's Word. This morning, our scripture reading comes from the book of Hebrews, chapter 11, and verse 1. Would you read with me, please? Now, faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. You may be seated. Almighty God, we thank you for the beauty of creation, that you make it happen repeatedly, just as you said, that the sun rises in the east every morning and sets in the west every evening, and you never deviate. The season follows season. We rejoice in the time when spring and things start to grow again. But Lord, you are with us in all seasons, in the growing season, and in the season where things are dying and we seem like things are going wrong. But Lord, you are there to bear us up, regardless of what's going on in our life. Lord, help us as we minister to be able to rejoice with those who rejoice and to cry with those who cry, that we would be your hands and feet and hugs and tears in this world you own. In your almighty name, amen.
If I can get you to stand once again as we sing this beautiful hymn, "But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine."
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Oh, yes.
Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with his goodness, lost in his love. Song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long.
Amen. You may be seated.
Saying that we should give a tithe. Yes, that's part.
Amen.
That's why I talked about tithes and gifts and giving and different ways, because it's what God impresses on you to give. When we have our mission offerings, and especially we have Annie Armstrong coming up, giving to the Annie Armstrong shouldn't come out of what you give to the church for its upkeep. That's above and beyond. That's what God has given you extra for. And God will speak to you and say, hey, you know, give this much. You'll be blessed. And son of a gun, you think, how am I going to give that? And all of a sudden, it's there. And so as we see here in our stewardship portion, when I talk about giving, is that the Bible, the truth in the Bible, is that God's people give gratefully. And that's what it's about. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time that we have to come and worship you with our gifts of love. And we know that you are always watching over us. You would never ask us to do something that is impossible. And we just have to put our faith in you. And we ask this in your holy name. Amen.
As we get ready to sing this song, I just want to share this with you real quick. When it comes down to the music, we hear music every day in our lives, and we hear people singing or playing a piece, but the thing is how we worship and how it affects us. And for me, music has always been a part of my life, not only as singing, but even writing music. But this past week, I've never felt so close as I feel today to my God. Because when we go through something, if we have had a relationship with God, you know what I'm talking about. Because you cannot be at peace even when you're going through that and you have your little talk with him. You begin to understand what is happening. And this song, even though it already been given to us, but better is one day. No matter what we're going through, God is always there for us. And no matter how bad it may seem, there is always going to be a brighter day. There's always going to be light at the end of the tunnel. If you believe and what the word says, and if you believe in him and what the Holy Spirit, when Jesus ascended, he said that he will always be here with us. Why? Because they send what? The Holy Spirit, the Comforter. It will be with us. And this song, Better Is One Day, oh, it's a testimony for me today, because this past week, was a rough week, but you know what? It's been a better and a brighter day each day than when I was going through this. So right now, we're going to celebrate and praise God, because the song says, better is one day. And I look forward to that day when I'll be standing there praising him 24/7. If we can't do it now, how can we expect to do it there? If we can see, I say this all the time, a ball game, when the team score a touchdown, what do? We jump up and we holler, we shout. Well, you know what? Herbert is my witness. I shout, even my little old dog, she stands up and she shouts with me, because I love my God. What you see here, I'm like this all the time. I'm crazy. I'm crazy in love with my Jesus. So let us sing, Better Is One Day. Let us praise God.
is satisfied. Within your presence, I see beneath the shadow of your wings.
Say it with me.
Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. Thousand elsewhere.
Well, you don't hear me.
One thing I ask, and I would see, to see your beauty, to find you in the place your glory dwells. One thing I ask, and I would see, to see your beauty, to find you in the place your glory dwells. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. My heart and flesh cry out for you, the living God. Your spirit's water for my soul. I've tasted and I've seen. Come once again to me. I will draw near to you. I will draw near to you.
Oh, thank you, Jesus.
Better is one day in your courts. Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than thousands elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts.
Oh, yeah.
Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere.
Yes.
Better is one day in your courts.
Yes.
Better is one day in your house. Better is one day in your courts than a thousand elsewhere. Better is one day in your courts.
Oh, yeah.
Better is one day.
Into that spirit. And when I say close, you know, next week's message is the end of this series, and then we are right there at Palm Sunday, Good Friday, Easter. This year, it has just come up fast. Today, as we continue in this series about extraordinary people in the Bible, we're looking at a person who's so little known, she doesn't even have a name. A name's not given to her in the Bible. Yet she is considered extraordinary because she successfully challenged Jesus for which he commanded her. Now, this story that I'm going to be relating, I'm coming out of Mark 7, verses 24 to 30, but you can find the same story in Matthew 15, in verses 21 to 28. It's just a little short one, but it's straightforward. And basically, the facts are simple. Trying to stay secluded, Jesus heads off to the city of Tyre, where he finds a house to stay in until he's ready to continue his ministry. Then, while he's there, a woman with a demon-possessed daughter barges in and intrudes on his solitude. Now, in the story, it looks like Jesus was hesitating about giving her, you know, what we would call the time of day, you know, if he was going to help her or not. But she stays and persists until she gets what she desires, which was the healing of her daughter. The facts of the story are simple, but what I hope that you'll see as we study this a little deeper is that this woman was truly extraordinary. Now, we need to understand, or I want to help you understand a little bit about the time frame in which this was happening here in the Bible. About this time, John the Baptist has been murdered, you know, he's been beheaded. When Jesus learns about that, he sort of steps back and wants to go pray. But he's followed by all of these people. So his disciples are telling him, you know, we have all these people here. What are we going to do with them? Well, this is the feeding of the 5,000. And after that is accomplished, he instructs his disciples to get on a boat and head to Bethsaida. And while they are trying to row across the Sea of Galilee, Jesus stayed behind for some solitude to pray. And when he finished, he noticed that the disciples, as it says, were straining at the oars because the wind was against them. And it's at this time that we see that he walks on the water out to the boat. This is the same time that he calls Peter, and Peter walks out. But once Jesus gets to the boat, the winds are calmed, after which they continue across the lake to Gennesaret. And here, you know, being Jesus, he's recognized, and people start bringing all their sick out to be healed. Because wherever he went, you know, people knew who he was. They knew that he could perform miracles. He could heal the sick. And then the Pharisees come up to him. They corner him. They sort of give him the third degree. And it's at this point we read in Mark 7, the first part of 24, Jesus left that place and went to the vicinity of Tyre. Now, remember, the Bible doesn't say he went to the city. It just says he went to that vicinity. In fact, In Matthew, it says he went to the vicinity of Tyre and Sidon. And both of those are on the coast northwest of the Sea of Galilee. Here's a map that shows you that area, you know, where he was traveling. We don't know the exact spot, but he was going northwest up toward Tyre. You know, it was an ancient city, but today it's a modern one. You know, it's 50 miles south of Beirut and about 100 miles northwest of Jerusalem. It's located on the Mediterranean coast. Today, it's a very popular area, a touristy area that's full of ports. So this is the area he was going to. Now, it's at this particular point in the Gospels where we see just how popular Jesus had become. You know, he had achieved what we would call a celebrity status. You know, he was known as a miracle worker. He had crossed over the Sea of Galilee, landed there at Gennesaret, thinking, well, I'm getting away from the crowds. But Matthew 4:24 says, news about him spread all over Syria, and people brought to him all who were ill with various diseases, those suffering from severe pain, the demon-possessed, those having seizures, and the paralyzed, and he healed them. You know, what we have to understand, you know, when we see him going over and going up into that area, that he sought a residence in a foreign land indicates that his main purpose was to get some kind of rest. He wanted to get away from these crowds. And he didn't want to get away just from those pressing multitudes, but from the Pharisees and the Jewish leaders too, who were always harassing him about different doctrines and beliefs. So after Jesus arrived up in that area of Tyre and Sidon, somewhere up there, he secluded himself in a house, not wanting anybody to know he was there. Now, there is no information in the Gospels about what kind of house it was or whose house it was. You know, there's no information in the Gospels as to why he actually chose to go to the area of Tyre. You know, some suggest he just wanted to get out of the country for a while in order to spend some quiet time with his disciples to teach and to pray. Now, it's safe to assume that the purpose of Jesus's movement into this region wasn't to go on a missionary journey to the Gentiles. That, you know, don't even think about that. Because remember, his ministry was to proclaim the kingdom first to the Jews, then to the Gentiles. So to get some much needed rest, he withdrew from Israel. And you have to understand that this is the only time in the record of Jesus's life that he is seen leaving the borders of Israel and going directly into a pagan land. Yet his desire for a quiet rest or for solitude was short-lived. Mark 7:25. In fact, as soon as she heard about him, a woman whose little daughter was possessed by an impure spirit came and fell at his feet. Now, I want to just sort of slow down here for a minute and address this idea of demon possession or being possessed by an evil spirit. In biblical times, almost like today, there are all sorts of ailments. Now, you know, in our country, earlier on, when somebody got sick, they called it consumption. Yeah. What's consumption? Well, it who knows what it was. It was just a name they gave to it. But when someone got sick and no one could determine what the illness was, here in biblical times, they labeled it as demon possession. Now, granted, there were some misdiagnoses similar to today, but just like biblical times, when we see someone that's acting strange or experiencing some sort of psychotic behavior, we want to label it. Yeah, most of the time we just point to them and say, that person's crazy. But, you know, that's not really a diagnosis. There are 30 or more psychotic terms used today to label people. Unfortunately, the doctors leave out any possibility of a spiritual component. Because we live here in America, we discount the idea that there may be a spiritual root to some psychological problems. Now, remember a while back, there was a shooting at a naval yard in Washington, D.C. A young man, he had clearance to the base, entered and randomly shot 12 people before he was killed. Now, if you kept up with the news, you may have seen that when they found his journals and letters, the reason he said he did it was because he felt that the government was transmitting some sort of low-frequency electromagnetic ray into his brain. Yeah. Unfortunately, the man's not alive, and we'll never know what the issue really was. People labeled his actions as some sort of psychotic break, you know, some kind of behavior. Few, if any, would recognize it as being demonic or spiritual. Because our belief in scientific and psychological evidence, we don't want to acknowledge that there might be a spiritual component to major illnesses. Yet in third world countries, demonic possession is quite common. There are videos of people that definitely appear to have a demonic element to them. And these videos would just send a chill up your spine if you watch them. And when we talk about this is what's known as spiritual warfare. You know, it's the same thing Bill was talking about a few minutes ago. This past week, you know, he's lost power to his office. He lost his internet. He's lost customers. This is all the devil's work because we're coming upon Easter. And Bill is trying to develop a Easter service that is meaningful, and the devil knows it. You know, this is what we see happening today. You know, now, in our story, it doesn't matter what we think. All that matters is that this lady that accosted Jesus believed her daughter was demon-possessed. And not only that, she believed it so much that her maternal instincts drove her to go and not only find somebody who would believe her, but the one person who could heal her daughter. Yet this particular woman had no right, at least in Jewish culture, to seek help from someone like Jesus, because Jesus was a Jew. Mark 7:26. The woman was a Greek, born in Syrian Phoenicia. She begged Jesus to drive the demon out of her daughter. So, You know, the question begs, why was she seeking help from a Jew? You know, she wasn't a Jew. She was a Greek born in Syrian Phoenicia. So we must understand something here. You know, when, you know, we're not talking about a Greek citizen. You know, when the verse says that she was a Greek born in Syrian Phoenicia, you know, it's not implying that she's a citizen of Greece. Because in the Jewish mind, you were either Jewish or you were Greek. To the Israelites who were conquered by Alexander the Great, a Greek was any foreigner because most all foreigners spoke Greek. Greek was the common language. And I want to point out here that when we study the Bible, the terms Gentile and Greek are not necessarily referring to the same people group. Since the New Testament refers to Christians as spiritual Israel, it uses Gentiles as a synonym for non-Christians, whereby the Jews referred to non-Jews as Greeks. And this woman lived in Syrian Phoenicia. So because of that, like Rahab, she had several strikes against her. First, you know, first, sort of like today, she was a woman, okay? And as a woman, she didn't have a lot of status. You know, how long has it taken women here in the United States to get any kind of status? Well, it's still going on. You know, they finally got the right to vote, but yet they weren't paid the same as a man. Doing the same job, that woman would get paid less than that man. You know, there's a lot of inconsistencies here. Well, no different than in biblical times. In biblical times, women were treated on the level of livestock. Then, because she was Greek, it meant she was exposed to some of the despicable things of the culture, including worship of foreign gods. You know, she may have even had her own household gods. We don't know. And the third strike that she had against her is she had a demon-possessed daughter. You know, who wants to go over and visit somebody with a demon-possessed daughter? You know, she's just by herself. And she had all these things against her that caused her to be considered unclean, untouchable to the Jewish people and their religious leaders. But even with all this against her, because she had that maternal love of a mother to find healing for her daughter, she sought out Jesus. She had heard about him. She knew about him. She sought him out to drive out that demon. And before I really get into Jesus' response, I want to jump over to Matthew, because Matthew gives a fuller picture of how desperate the woman was and the initial response of Jesus and the disciples. In Matthew 15, 22 to 23, it says, "A Canaanite woman from that vicinity came to him, crying out, 'Lord, Son of David, have mercy on me. My daughter is demon-possessed and suffering terribly.' Jesus did not answer a word. So his disciples came to him and urged him, 'Send her away, for she keeps crying out to us.'" Now, you get the picture that this poor, desperate woman is inside the house begging for relief for her little daughter, and Jesus just seems to ignore her. You know, we would say he was dissing her. And the disciples picked up on that. So they urged Jesus, you know, get rid of this woman. Send her away. She's annoying. Finally, when Jesus decides to give her an answer, the answer he gave, you know, wasn't only weird. You know, it actually, when you think about it, sounds mean. In Mark 27, he says, "First, let the children eat all they want," he told her, "for it is not right for the children's bread to take the children's bread and toss it to the dogs." Now, this doesn't sound like the same man who just delivered the Sermon on the Mount. But Matthew clarifies what Jesus said. In Matthew 15:24, he answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of Israel." You know, this is one of those passages as that we as Christians like to avoid because Jesus seems to be uncaring and insensitive. And if we were to look up a list of Jesus's traits, you know, the words uncaring and insensitive wouldn't be on that list. So what this tells us is that maybe there's something else going on here. This is also one of those instances where we need to read between the lines in order to figure out what's happening. And Jesus was engaging in what we would call wordplay. He's testing this woman's knowledge of him to see if he can discover some sort of faith in her. Now, we need to understand that in this passage, when Jesus speaks about the children, he's talking about Jewish people. The Jews were the children of Abraham, the patriarch of the Jewish faith. And since the Jews were considered Abraham's children, most scholars believe in this passage that Jesus was referring to the Jewish people. You know, Jesus said it wasn't right to take the children's, the Jewish people's bread, food meant for them, and give it to a foreigner. You know, the Jews were God's chosen people, special children. And when you have a special child, what happens is that that child takes on a little bit of pride to the point that they look down on anyone else that's outside their family circle. And the Jewish people looked at outsiders, the Gentiles and the Greeks, as dogs. Now, in this case, we're not talking about these cuddly little dogs that we have at home. We're talking about scavengers. We're talking about dogs that would roam the streets of Jerusalem eating trash and the carcasses of dead animals. Those dogs were considered unclean. When they, the Jewish people, applied the designation dog to the Gentile or a Greek, they're basically saying, you are an unclean person. You know, just stay back. You know, stay at arm's length. You're on the scale of a scavenger dog. Consequently, because you're an unclean dog, you are also excluded from God's blessings. And when you think about this comment by Jesus, you know, now it comes across rude and offensive. So offensive that the woman had every right to just stomp out of the house saying, "I didn't come here to be insulted." But she didn't do that. She stood her ground. And we might think, why would somebody put up with that? Well, it goes back to the idea that maybe she saw something that we didn't see, or that the people around her didn't see. She saw a window of hope. And she saw enough hope through the crack of that closed door that she knew maybe Jesus was implying that he was really going to heal her little girl. Now, in order to understand that, we need to back up a little bit and think about this concept of dogs. When the Jews used the term dogs, especially if you look in the Old Testament, they were thinking of it in a derogatory sense. They were thinking about a scavenger. But in many cultures of the day, dogs were esteemed. In Egypt, some dogs were gods. Then you had cultures that dogs were used for hunting and shepherding. In the Greek culture, which was similar to ours today, they would have dogs as household pets. In fact, I read an archaeological article about how they found a lady buried with her little dog. You know, this was thousands of years ago. It was part of the Greek culture. The Greeks treated their dogs like we treat ours today. So when Jesus referred to dogs, he wasn't talking about scavenger dogs. And knowing that you all study for years the Greek language, if you look at the Greek word, root word used here in the original Greek, it presents the idea of a little dog. A house dog, a puppy. That's the image you get if you were to read between the lines and understand the original language. And knowing this about this particular word, Jesus' response could be paraphrased to say, first let the children eat all they want, for it's not proper to give the master's dinner to the little puppy sitting under the table before the children get what they need. You know, when you look at it like that, it takes the edge off of it. Yet even if it does take the edge off of it, it still doesn't explain why this woman could have seen this as a window of hope. You know, a window of opportunity that Jesus was going to do something. That Jesus was actually going to heal her little girl. What we must realize is that she understood Jesus was talking in parable. Now, remember, a parable is an earthly story with a heavenly lesson or meaning. Here, the earthly part of it is about that puppy sitting under the table and the children sitting around the table. The heavenly part of it goes into the spiritual realm, where Jesus was saying, as children of Abraham, those children have the first right to sit around that table and to eat all the good food. You know, that's their right. And this woman understood that. She might have even understood Jesus came first to redeem the lost sheep of Israel. She wasn't arguing that point at all. Her response to Jesus basically said, I get that, but I also understand something else. She understood that when you have a little dog and you're eating at the table, eventually something's going to fall off the table, either by accident or intentionally. You know, that's her response in Mark 7:28. Lord, she replied, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs. She's saying that any good master of the house who has children isn't going to kick that dog out of the way if, you know, some food falls on the floor. He's going to let the dog, you know, eat what he wants. You know, they didn't have that 5-minute rule where you can leave it down there long enough and pick it up, put it back on your plate. You know, once it hit the floor, that was it. She was saying that I don't want all the bread. I don't want the main course. I just want that crumb that falls off the table. And she knew by being around Jews that the feast God wants to give his children was phenomenal. She knew that God's grace was available to his chosen people, and that God desired his people to live in peace and prosperity and health and wealth. She was saying, with that much grace on the table, can't you just let me have a little crumb or two that falls off it and let me eat it? All I need is just a little crumb of God's grace to take care of my daughter. That's all I want. That got Jesus' attention. He was so impressed with this woman that he told her in Mark 7:29, "For such a reply, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." Leaving Jesus, Mark tells us that she went home and found her child lying on the bed and the demon gone, meaning the child was healed. You know, this is the second miracle that Jesus conducted from a distance. You know, the first being the story of the centurion and his son found in Luke 7. Now, closing on this, what was it that made this woman so extraordinary? Well, it goes back to the idea that she was an outcast. She was a marginalized person. She had no status. She had no rights. She was probably a single parent. She was probably a pagan believer. She had a demon-possessed daughter. But you know what? She didn't care. She had the heart of a mother, and she was going to find that person who could heal her little girl no matter what it took. And when she felt like she was being dismissed, she didn't stomp out. She didn't run away. She stayed until she got that blessing she was asking for. And what sums up her character in this whole story is that she was an extraordinary woman because of the faith that Jesus saw in her. In fact, Matthew closed this story by Jesus' words in Matthew 15:28. "Then Jesus said to her, 'Woman, you have great faith. Your request is granted.' And her daughter was healed at that moment." Now, what lessons can we get out of this? Well, let me tell you, the first lesson is, don't quit praying for your family. Don't quit praying for people, especially the people that, for whatever reason, can't pray for themselves. Don't stop praying for the people who don't want to pray for themselves. Keep praying. Make prayer a discipline of your life. Now, people don't like that word discipline because it sounds difficult. But it's only difficult if you make it difficult. Like any discipline, you just don't try it once, and if you don't get the answer, you give up. That would be like if I decided to go to a gym to get into shape. You know, I get there, work out for an hour, and go to the scales and see, you know, I haven't lost any weight, so I just quit. You know, now, I wouldn't do that because I know exercise is a discipline. Therefore, why would we think what's true in the earthly realm wouldn't be true in the spiritual realm? Prayer is a discipline. In 1 Thessalonians, we're told to pray continually. And as we pray, we're eventually coming in to God's presence, which is my second point. Jesus can't and will not hide his presence from anybody. And you know why? Because Jesus is love. And so again, when you pray, pray in an act of compassion and out of an act of love. What you're desiring for yourself, you're desiring for other people. If you'll just pray and seek, you'll find Jesus because Jesus is love. And the third point is, don't let yourself be marginalized. This woman was an outcast. Now, I know there are people today, even Christians, who feel marginalized. They think because of all of the stuff and muck in their past that they're not worthy to eat off the table of God's grace. And this passage says, no, that's not true. Unlike the woman in the story who had to sit under the table like a puppy because of the saving grace of Jesus Christ, we get to sit around the table with God's children. It's all about faith. We must learn that faith is the currency of God's economy. We may not like it, but everything in God's economy operates on faith. This woman was extraordinary. She was faithful, but she was an outcast. Regardless of being an outcast, she was still faithful. So faithful that she continued to seek out God until she got the answer she desired. And if there's anybody here today that's dealing with something on a family, you know, with a family member or a friend that you feel like giving up on, you know, you feel like prayer isn't working and you think that Jesus isn't listening, you know, this woman should be an example to you. You need to continue to pray over and over and over. You know, make prayer a discipline. Begin to believe in faith that those things that you are sure of actually will manifest itself within you. That loaf of God's blessing that's on the table will continue to spill out to us in faith as we believe. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time that we've been able to study about this Syrophoenician woman, that these lessons that we learn from this about your grace and love, about persistence in prayer. We know that you are talking to us, that through you all things are possible. And we just ask that you continue to help us understand this, to build up our strength in prayer so that it can become a discipline in our life, that we can just look at it, pray, and know that it is accomplished. And we thank you, Lord, for sending your Son to help all of this become possible in our lives. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.